all right? Can you hear me? Yeah.
So the next speaker is Dr. Riccioni from King's College. He's talking about E11 and M3.
Okay, so it's a pleasure to thank the organizers of this conference for having invited me here to give this talk, whose title is E11 MMM Theory. So E11 is an infinite dimensional Kac-Moody algebra, which was conjectured by Peter West in 2001 to be a symmetry of the, well, as you will see, of the low energy action of M theory. So I will explain what this is, and I will try to convince you that this conjecture is, say, likely to be correct, in particular, given some recent results, some recent developments by Peter West and myself at King's College, which will be the main body of the talk. But first of all, let me emphasize what the main point is of the conjecture. So E11 is conjectured to be non-linearly realized in the low energy action of M theory. So let me first remind you what we all know very well about low energy actions, but non-linear realizations in massless maximal supergravities. So all massless maximal supergravities in dimension less than 10 arise from can be obtained from dimensional reduction of either of both 11 dimensional supergravity and 2B supergravity. So the theory in any dimension below 10 is unique and has a global symmetry G. So the scalars parameterize a manifold G over H, and where H is the maximal compact subgroup of G. That is to say, the symmetry G is non-linearly realized in a scalar sector. Then, well, I mean, as we know, in from five dimension downwards, this group G becomes exceptional. So this is what we know about this group. So in particular, you see, for instance, in eight dimensions, you see the first non-abelian enhancement. So if you compactify from type 2b, you will get on a torus, on a two torus, you will get SL2R from type 2b times SL2 from the torus. If you compactify from 11 dimensions, you will get SL3. So the fact that the symmetry actually is enhanced to SL3 plus SL2, which is compatible with the fact that the theory is unique. And then you get SL5 in 7, SO5,5 in 6, and so on in 6, 7, and 8. So we want to generalize this in order to include all the fields of the low energy theory, particularly in 11 dimensions. So this is tricky, of course, because this would require to introduce generators with carry space-time indices. So let's see people managed to try to do this like long time ago. These people in particular tried to realize non-linear gravity. So it's basically the same thing as usual in scalar courses. So consider this group element G, which is the exponential of xp times this exponential of x is the coordinate, h is a field, k are the generators of SLD, and p commutes with itself, and that's this computational relation with the generators of SLD. So the idea is to formulate gravity as a nonlinear realization of this group. So let me just skip the details. So the theory, as usual, is invariant under the left action of the global symmetry and the right action of the local SOD. So this is the Mirica transform, omega transform, so like this. So as a result, the Mirica transform only transforms with respect to the local symmetry. And if one expands using the commutation relation we had in the previous transparency, if one expands this, one gets this, and then it turns out that this gives the right form of omega in terms of the spin connection, in terms of the field bind. So the idea of West was in 2000 was to generalize this to include the fields of 11 dimensional supergravity. So let's consider the commutation relations of the previous slide together with an object R A B C which has three antisymmetric indices of SL11. So R3 with R3 is a generator at 6. And we write down this group element here like this. So A, so this is a, there is a three-form field and a six-form field. And then you work out the nonlinear realization, and then you impose that the field equations are basically, so you get G2 minus 1 dG, and you impose that the field equations are duality relations between the the field strength of this of A3 and the field strength of the A6, and using this combination relation you get exactly the field equations, the duality relations of 11 dimensional supergravity. So the conjecture is, so what is E11? E11 appears at this point as the smallest Katz-Moody, so this group is not a Katz-Moody group, to start with. So E11 is the smallest Katz-Moody group that contains this group here. So what is E11? Well, the Dynkin diagram of E11, is this object here, which is something that's called very extended E8. So it's basically E8, so this is E8, so it's E8 with three extra nodes, hence the name E11. And if you can, of course, from this thing, compute the Cartan matrix, and you realize that this Cartan matrix has negative eigenvalues. There is some roots in the algebra that have length square, with a negative length square, and this means that basically, since the length of the root is not bounded from below, this means that the algebra is infinite dimensional. There are infinitely many roots. And, well, really, not much is known in general about these groups, this type of group. In particular, not much is known about 11, which is, well, it's a good thing if you want to work on it. And so the basic idea is to write each positive root in, well, this is very, very basic, the idea is to write each positive root in terms of the simple roots of A10, which is this one, the gravity line A10, so which is SL11, plus the exceptional root alpha 11. So we define the level as the number of times the simple root alpha 11 appears in the composition of any root in terms of simple roots. And since we want to decompose the adjoint representation of V11 in terms of representations of A10, what we want to see is the occurrence of the highest weight of A10 in the root of V11. So if you substitute this into the root, and then we compute the root square, the alpha square, the square length of the root, we get this relation where L is the level, A is the A to the minus one is the inverse Cartan matrix of A10 of SL11, and P are indeed the Dynkin indices. Okay, so what is the constraint of the length square? The fact that the E11 is a Katz-Moody algebra imposes that alpha square has to be equal to 2 or 0, minus 2, minus 4, and so on. So we basically just try and solve this equation level by level, imposing the alpha square is equal to these values. So if you do this, you realize, first of all, that at level 0, of course, you recover the generator of A10. At level 1, you have a solution which is P8 equals 1, and it's convenient to define the Q Dynkin indices, which are P11 minus 3, so Q8 becomes Q3, and you see that this is convenient because Q3 means a representation of A10 with 3 antisymmetric indices. So there is a root in E11 which is indeed a generator with 3 antisymmetric indices. So at level 2 you get an object with 6 antisymmetric indices, and so on. At level 3 you get this, Q8 equals 1, Q1 equals 1. So this is a Hooke-Yankter-Blow with 8 antisymmetric indices and 1. So what is this? This is an 8,1 generator which is associated to a field which has the indices to be associated with the dual graviton in 11 dimensions. So this is conjectured to be the dual graviton. Say, of course, if you increase the level, you get more and more generators. That is more and more fields. So this theory actually contains an infinite number of fields. All the generators so arise as multiple commutators of this guy R3. So the R6 is R3 commutator with R3, and so on. And the level is the number of times the R3 occurs in the commutator. So this is probably self-explained. So of course we have positive roots and negative. We have positive level and negative level generators, which is object with upstairs indices, object with downstairs indices. Somehow the nonlinear realization is roughly saying that we have to consider only the generators with upstairs indices, which is the we only have to consider positive level generators. So only the positive level generators are associated with the gauge fields. So all bosonic fields in this description are Gostom boson of E, or Gostom bosons of E11. And all the fields equation will turn out to be basically duality equations, because all the fields equations are first order. So what do you get? If you do it, so if you do just the next level, so we'll show what happens to level 3. If we do it at level 4, we get a solution which has Q10 equals 1 and Q1 equals 2. So this corresponds to a field which is 10, 1, 1 in 11 dimensions. So this is not actually a propagating field in 11 dimensions, because it's a 10 antisymmetric indices. But if you do the dimensional reaction to 10 dimensions, you realize that this object contains, among the rest, a form which has 9 antisymmetric indices. So this is a form whose field strength is a 10 form. This is dual to a mass. And actually, this is indeed the way in the nonlinear realization. This is the way in which, in the nonlinear realization, you describe massive 2A. So massive 2A corresponds to just giving a constant value to the field strength of this guy, as was shown by Peter and collaborators. But moreover, I mean, the theory is really unique. And what happens is really the choice of the gravity line that defines what is your background. So let me go back to 11 and see. Suppose you want to describe a 10-dimensional theory. So you need a gravity line which is A9, which is SL10. So you see, starting from the very extended node, I mean, you see that you have two options of obtaining A10 here, which is the following. So this is the 2A case, which is basically dimensional reduction. So you just take this node to be not to belong to a gravity line anymore. But you also have another option, which is you take this gravity line here, which is this one, which is type 2B. And you see that if you do it this way, you have a node here which is not connected to the gravity line. So this is really associated to an internal symmetry of the theory, which is SL2R of type 2B. And then you keep going. So in 9 dimensions, you will need an A8. So you have only one option in this case, which is this one. So again, the non-abelian symmetry is SL2. Then you go to 8 dimensions, and you get this gravity line. And these are the nodes which are not connected to the gravity line. So this corresponds to SL3 times SL2, and so on. You get SL5 in 7 dimensions, SO5,5 in 6, and then E6, E7, and E8 in 3 dimensions. Okay. So far so good. So what this is saying is that starting from the 11 dimensional nonlinear realization which contains the fields of 11 dimensional supergravity, these nonlinear realizations of course contain the fields of the supergravity in the corresponding dimension. But what about all the other fields? Well, first step towards in this direction, but you can see it happening in type 2B. So let me consider in type 2B all the fields that arise, actually only all the forms that arise from E11. So I'm restricting my attention to objects that are forms, so the objects that only have a single set of antisymmetric indices. So I'm writing down only I'm not writing down the scale. So you get from E11, you get a doublet of two forms, a four-form singlet, then you get a doublet of six forms. This object belongs to, this is a triplet, which is the adjoint of SL2, so a triplet of eight forms. And then you get two sets of 10 forms in 10 dimensions, which one is in this representation with the quadruplet of SL2, and this one is a doublet of SL2. So, of course, if you're interested in the dynamics, this 6-form will be the dual of the 2-form doublet. The 4-form there are duality relations, so this 4-form will give rise to a self-dual 4-form in the actual theory. These objects are dual to the scalar, so there are two scalars in the theory. You get three eight forms in the adjoint with, well, it turns out to get a constraint, so one of the field strengths of this guy is identically zero. And then in the E11 turns out you get these objects, which are, well, I mean, they're not propagating objects because these are 10 forms in 10 dimensions. So these are objects which have no field strength, basically. So in a completely different development, Bergsuf, Dero, Kestan, and myself in 2005 closed the supersymmetry algebra of type 2B in a so-called democratic formulation. So we were interested in finding out how many 10 forms the supersymmetry algebra of type 2B was actually describing. And in order to do that, we had to use a formulation in which all the fields are introduced together with their magnetic duals, and then you use duality relation to close the algebra. And so actually our main interest was to find out in which representation the Ramon-Ramon 10 form, which is the form to which the D9 brain is charged. So our interest was completely different. Actually, as far as I'm concerned, I wasn't even aware of these E11 results. But it turns out one finds exactly the same forms. And besides, there is also, from supersymmetry, you get the forms transformed to lower rank forms. So there is really a gauge algebra, an algebra transforming forms into forms. And this algebra is exactly the one that's predicted by E11. So it really, you are really describing the longer you're interested in the bosonic sector, you're really describing the same thing. So the same happens actually in type 2A. So the same analysis was done in type 2A, and it turns out that the supersymmetry algebra closes among the rest on a 9 form, which again, as I said, is an object whose field strength is dual to Roman's cosmological constant. And then you can introduce, it turns out that the algebra allows you to introduce 2 10 forms. Well, this is one interesting point, which is this algebra describes both massless and massive type 2A. And of course, if you just look at supergravity, if you take the limit, the case in which the mass, the Roman's mass is different from zero, this algebra doesn't seem to arise from 11 dimensional supergravity. But it turns out, again, there is precise agreement with the 11 prediction. So 11 really predicts the same algebra, bosonic algebra, in the same field content. So what about dimensions lower than 10? So in dimensions from 7 to 3, all the possible gauged maximal supergravities have been classified by these authors. And so the idea is to describe the gauging in a formulation which is covariant with respect to the global symmetry G. So we heard about the embedding tensor yesterday already. So I'm just going to tell, a few things about this. So the idea is the gauging corresponds to substitute the derivative with a covariant derivative in which the U1 vectors transforming in some representation of G are basically embedded by this embedding tensor, which is a constant. Well, which will turn out to be a constant then in the theory, which belongs to the representation of the vector times the adjoint of G. So, well, I'm not going to give the details. It turns out that this representation is, of course, reducible, and then supersymmetry and the Jacobi identity of the gauge group impose constraint on these representations. So only a few representations are actually allowed by the gauging. And this is the result. So in 7 dimensions, for instance, you get the embedding tensor belongs to the 15 plus the 40. So these are only turning on the embedding tensor in this representation, this allows a consistent gauging of the 7 dimensional maximal theory. And so on, you get these other representations in dimensions for 6 or 3. In a different development, in 9 dimensions, it was found that all the possible gauge supergravities have been classified by a case-by-case analysis. In this case, these authors found all the possible mass deformation of the theory, which turns out to belong to the 2 plus 3 of the non-abelian symmetry group of the nine-dimensional theory, which is SL2. So what do we want to do in this? So we want to see how this can arise from E11. Well, first of all, supersymmetry. So let me go back to embedding tensor. It turns out that supersymmetry relates the gauging, I mean the gauge coupling, to the mass deformations of the theory. And it turns out that these mass deformations belong to the same representation of the embedding tensor. So we are looking for masses that belong to these representations. And then we play the same game that we played in for type 2a. So we assume that that these masses are basically are dual to d minus 1 forms in the dimensions. So in d dimensions, there will be a d minus 1 form that has a d form field strength, which is dual to this mass here in each dimension. Okay, how do we do this? So we have to classify the generators of E11 in order to find this result, so to find this d minus 1 forms. And the basic idea is that we really have to classify all the possible generators. So the basic idea is that the indices of each field, that is the indices of each generator of E11, has to be equal to 3 times the level. As I said, the level is the number of times R3, of course. So introducing L times R3 corresponds to having 3L indices. So this 3L has to be equal to J times QJ, sum over all possible J's, because QJ corresponds, so for instance, Q3 corresponds to 3 indices. So if Q3 is 1, I have to do, this corresponds to 3 times Q3. So, but there is another possibility, which is the fact that the generator possesses 11 antisymmetric indices in 11 dimensions. Of course, this is not giving any representation of SL11, because this is, from SL11, this is just, 11 antisymmetric indices is just dual to a scalar, it's dual to no indices at all. But from the point of view of the nonlinearization, this makes a big difference, because a field with 11 antisymmetric indices is a gauge field, which is basically a pure gauge. So this is, this is the thing we have to do. So this equation, which seems very simple, turns out to be actually rather magic, and as we will see. So we want to substitute this equation into this expression for the square length of the root. So if we do this, we get this result, and you see here that the level has disappeared, of course, from the equation. And now we solve this, and this is actually very, very simple to solve. In particular, suppose you want to find all the propagating fields of the theory. So the propagating fields can't possess any 10 antisymmetric indices, because this wouldn't give rise to propagating fields, of course, neither 11 antisymmetric indices. So we just put in this equation, suppose you just put in this equation n equals 0, np10, and q10 equals 0. Well, it turns out if you do this, all the solutions you get are going to be of this form. So either a3 or a6 or a8,1, which is the 3 form, the 6 form and the dual graviton, plus an infinite set of solutions which possess 9 antisymmetric indices. So this, from the point of view of the little group SO9, is not going to give this is going to give really a duality relation. So all the objects that you get, basically, are infinitely many dual descriptions of the same fields. So you get that the propagating fields of this theory are exactly the propagating fields of 11-dimensional supergravity. Now you want to, of course, you want to see if you want, can do something else. In order to, we also want to get the d minus 1 forms in the dimensions. So we also have to classify other solutions of the root equation, which is, in particular, suppose you consider this equation, so the one with this root, the ones in which the 11 antisymmetric indices are 0 and 9 antisymmetric indices are 0. Only you take the possibility that only one set of 10 antisymmetric indices is 0. This can give rise to d minus 1 forms in any dimension above 2. And it turns out that if you put these values into this equation, again you're gonna get a finite number of solutions. And then you can do the same for the space-time filling forms, so the d forms in any indie dimensions. Again, in this case, you also have to consider these values, and again, you plug it into the root equation, and you get a finite number of solutions. So this is actually, I mean, really magical. And so this is just to summarize. Even if the theory contains an infinite number of generators, in any dimension above 2, the number of forms that this theory contains is finite, and is obtained by the dimensional reduction of these fields. So these are the propagating fields. In this column, I put the highest dimension for which these fields give rise to a form in the dimensional reduction. These are the fields that occur in these fields can give rise to d minus one forms, so to say objects which are dual to masses in the dimensions, and these are the space-time filling forms. These rise to space-time filling forms. So let me give you an example, which is the seven-dimensional case. So you take the fields from the table, and so you want to, for instance, suppose you want to get, if you find how many six forms the theory contains. So I'm taking objects which are in, the objects in the table, are, of course, have indices of SL11, so I want to compactify four indices, so the internal indices are indices of SL4, so in particular, A6 gives rise to a six-form singlet, which is a singlet of in seven dimensions, a singlet of SL4. Then the dual graviton 8,1 gives rise to a 4 bar process 20 bar of SL4, and so on. And then you get all, so this is all you get from E11. And then you sum up these representations, and you find that you get 15 bar plus 40 bar, which is exactly the complex conjugate of the representation of the masses that you get from the supersymmetric analysis. Okay, and then this is the result from the seventh form. Again, you get the forms you get can be enhanced to SL5 as it turns out. So this is the final table of all the forms obtained from E11, and you see that, well, I mean, for instance, in even dimension, these objects are always self-dual. So in the four forms in 10 are self-dual, the three forms in 8, the two forms in 6, and the one forms in 4. And so you have a duality line, self-duality line, and the things on the left are mirrored to the things on the right. But then you get this diagonal here, which contains all the massive deformation. These are all the differences that are dual from the mass. And this is in exact agreement with the supersymmetric prediction. And these are the space-time filling forms, which has only been computed in the 10-dimensional case, which is with symmetry. So this is basically new results. So we didn't compute the three forms in three dimension for some reason. We left it basically left it as an open project. And basically, a couple of days after a paper appeared, Bergsuf, the Beitzelier, and Nutma basically obtained the three forms at three dimensions as well, which are compatible with the results that belong to this representation. So what they did was use a computer program to get the d minus one forms and the d forms in each dimension. So they used E11 in the dimension of interest, and they get exactly the results are exactly in agreement. I mean, this of course, I mean, if you do it in each dimension separately, E11, you should get the same results, which is what they did there. So, to summarize, we find a complete agreement with all the known supergravity results, but it's more than that. I mean, for 11 really provides an 11-dimensional origin of all the massive, of the gauge deformation of maximal supergravities. Well, I mean, the eight-dimensional case wasn't... So we also predict the massive deformation in eight dimensions. As it turns out, Bernard De Witt in private communication in... Florence told me that the supergravity analysis is again in perfect agreement with E11. And we also get all the 10 forms, the d forms in any dimension below 10. So to summarize, E11 really provides a completely unified description of all supergravities. And something I didn't have time to mention is the fact that also the nonlinear realization encodes all the dynamical features also in the gauge theory, as it turns out. So I will conclude here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So you have questions or comments? Yes.
So can you describe the fermionic field?
Okay, very good. So indeed, I mean, what I did was completely bosonic, and in a sense, I mean, the symmetry is so strong in this, it's so constrained in such a way that basically you don't need the fermions to find the bosonic dynamics. But indeed, it turns out you can describe the fermions. So the fermions would you're really doing a jig over H. So the fermions should transform respect to H. In this case is something complicated, which is called the Catalan evolution invariant subalgebra of this group. So this would be the generalization of the maximal compact subgroup of G. And the E10 group in Potsdam have worked out a formulation from which you can introduce the fermions, and this should work for E11 as well. I'm not an expert. But.
Can you get how they enter into the duality relations, the fermions?
So what you get is that the result of which is completely compatible with this picture, in which the only dynamical fields are the fields of the corresponding supergravity, is the fact that the, for instance, in 11 dimensions, the gravity, you know, is a representation of this group H. So if you can only introduce just the gravity, you know, as it seems, but I'm not an expert.
Yes.
In your picture of the gravity degrees of freedom, the generator which has 8 antisymmetric index plus 1 is the dual to the field bind, to the spin connection, or to the graviton?
It's dual, so 8,1 is dual to 1,1 in 11 dimensions, dual to the graviton. So you dualize one set of indices.
To the graviton?
To the graviton, yes.
But usually in ordinary gravity, there is no symmetry which is directly associated to the graviton, rather it's parametrized using the field bind, which is dual to the translational generator and the spin connection with the dual to Lorentz generators. So how can you have a generator which is somehow dual to dual of the graviton?
Well, so suppose you want to dual, so in this is something you can see very easily in the free theory. Suppose you have so the Riemann tensor would be a 2,2 object. So basically you just dualize one set of indices, you get a 9,2. So this 9,2 is basically double derivative of an 8,1, which would be, so the duality relation would be really Riemann is star 9,2 in the free theory. Well, we can, yeah.
Yes, Paul.
We know that there are higher derivative corrections to 11-dimensional supergravity. Are these supposed to be taken into account by this formalism, or are we to interpret it purely as a kind of low energy symmetry?
Well, this, as far as I can tell, is only low energy. I mean, of course, it would be nice to generalize this to consider higher derivatives, which we don't know. Yeah, but of course, I mean, this wouldn't.
But the hope is that it would be generalizable to. That seems unlikely, but that would be the hope, I suppose.
Well, the first question you can ask is what happens to U-duality if you want to. So, what happens, for instance, to U-duality if you want to include higher derivatives? Is U-duality preserved? So this is what would be the first question you want to answer, and then it might be some discrete version of E11 or something. We don't know. Not that.
More questions? If not, let's thank the speaker again.